Ahora vamos a hablar con nuestro compañero Imran Kamyana, dirigente nacional de la lucha de Pakistán, la principal organización trotskista y de izquierda en el país. Hola Imran, quería comenzar preguntándote cómo están caracterizando ustedes la actual situación internacional que se ha creado a partir de la pandemia y de la crisis económica y cuál es la dinámica que ven.
First of all, it must be clear that the coronavirus pandemic has laid bare the inability and impotence of capitalism as a system in front of the whole world. And now the world is entering into a very deep recession, into a very severe economic crisis. But the point here is that the coronavirus has not caused the crisis of capitalism. It has only intensified and exacerbated the already existing crisis within the capitalist system world over. So one crisis would give birth to another crisis. The economic crisis would be translated into the social crisis, into the political crisis, and there would be many upheavals in the coming months and years against the austerity which the states would be imposing on their people in the coming days. Because under capitalism, the price of every crisis is to be paid by the working masses. So there would be resistance, there would be protests, there would be movements, and there can even be revolutions in the coming days in many countries.
¿Qué nos podrías contar de la situación de la lucha de clases en el subcontinente?
First of all, I would be discussing the situation in India, particularly after the BJP government, which came into power in 2014. The BJP is basically a Hindu fundamentalist tendency, a fundamentalist reactionary party. And its rise as a party and as a social force was a product of the failure of the communist parties of India to present any alternative to capitalism. They are still presenting the same obsolete two-stages solution to the crisis of capitalism, in which first the working class is supposed to support the so-called progressive bourgeoisie. And in the second step, after many decades or many centuries there, the conditions would be ripe for a socialist revolution. So this is an outright stupid and reactionary theory, which they have been presenting since 1940s in Indian subcontinent. And instead of their very large size and huge membership, they are unable to present any revolutionary way out of the crisis of the capitalism. When the bourgeoisie was not able to develop a modern society, and the Marxists or the communist parties were not able to present any solution to the masses, the Hindu fundamentalism emerged as a third political force in the Indian society in 1980s. And after coming into power, they have pursued a policy of neoliberalism, very aggressive neoliberalism. I would also like to discuss free market economy in India after 1991, because it has been presented as a successory of free market policies all over the world. And there has been a propaganda that Indian economy is the fastest growing economy in the world, or one of the fastest growing economies in the world, and India is progressing very rapidly. I would present a figure that to generate 1% extra employment, the Indian economy needs at least a growth rate of 10%. While in 1970s and 80s, when there was an element of state planning in the economy to increase the employment of 2%, the growth rate needed to be 4 or 5%. So this is the real character of the neoliberal growth, that it is a joyless, jobless growth, which doesn't rely on industrialization or employment generation, but on fictitious financial activities such as real estate and stock market. So as I said earlier, that there is a fundamentalist party in government in India. And as the crisis of Indian capitalism has deepened during the last few years, the religious bigotry and religious fundamentalist tendencies within the Indian state and government has only increased. And they are now using the religious fundamentalism and Hindu fascism to divide the society and perpetuate their rule. And against, even in this scenario, there have been many movements of very courageous and audacious movements of Indian working class, in which the workers have risen against and challenged the against the state and challenged the system. There have been a very huge farmers movement in India in March 2018, in which 50,000 farmers marched for 180 kilometers to the capital of Maharashtra state, Mumbai, and they were demanding that their loans be waived off. Similarly, in 2019, there have been a very courageous movement of Honda factory workers in Indian state of Haryana, in which 4,000 to 5,000 workers participated, and they went on strike against the layoffs of the 300 contract workers. And this movement went on for like many weeks. And then after that, the management of the Honda had to negotiate with the workers. Similarly, this July, on just a few days ago, 500,000 workers of state-owned Coal India Limited, which is a state-owned enterprise, went on a three-day strike against the proposed privatization of the enterprise. And there was about 50%, more than 50% decline in the production of the Coal India Limited. In the past years, we have also seen general strikes in India. There have been four general strikes after 2016, in which millions of workers participated. And if you look at the numbers of people, number of the people participating in the strikes, they can surely be called the biggest strikes in the human history, in which about 150 to 200 million workers participated against the neoliberal labor reforms and privatization and other basic issues. Similarly, there have been protests in India last year, at the end of the last year, against an act which was discriminating the Indian citizens on the basis of religion. It was the Citizenship Amendment Act, in which they were giving citizen to refugees, to some refugees from other countries who have been in India since 2014, but that citizenship was not available for the Muslims. So there was a protest movement against this step of the government. Similarly, there have been youth movements in India, particularly in Jawaharlal Nehru University in Delhi, against the sedition charges on some of the student leaders. Right now, Pakistan is going through an IMF program, in which government is pursuing an aggressive policy of privatization, of layoffs, and other labor reforms. And there have been severe stagflation, with inflation rate going from 3 to 4% to 14%, while the growth rate declining from 5% to minus 0.6%. And this situation is having its repercussions, and people are now more and more angry against these neoliberal measures of government of Pakistan. There has been some movements in the past months and the years against privatization. One of the movement was by the utility stores workers. It is a state institution of grocery stores, and the government wanted to privatize it, but they resisted. And one of the very audacious movement recently have been the movement of young doctors, nurses, and paramedical staff against the proposed privatization of the healthcare system. And one important development, which has been very important for the revolutionaries and the working masses of the country, which has set an example in front of the masses, is the development and establishment of GHA, Grand Health Alliance, in which all the organizations and trade unions and associations of healthcare sectors have joined on one platform against the privatization and other anti-workers reforms in the healthcare sector. And they have successfully resisted the attempt of privatization of healthcare. One important development recently has been a meeting which held today, in which 23 trade unions and other labor organizations participated. It was held in Lahore. The railway workers have declared that they would be shutting down the trains in country on 5th of August if their demands are not met. And similarly, the clerical association, which is called APCA, All Pakistan Clerical Association, have also declared that they would be shutting down offices if their demands are not met. And what they are demanding is a rise in wages according to the rise in inflation, and an end to layoffs, and an end to the policy of privatization. So there have been movements, but still they are not very huge in time and space, but there have been struggles and there have been resistance by the workers. But now we can see that these movements and are getting more organized, more collective, and more united as they move forward and as the crisis of capitalism deepens in Pakistan and world over.
Te saco un poco de tema. ¿Qué opinan del plan de anexión de Cisjordania por parte del Estado sionista de Israel?
First of all, I would like to comment on the very existence of Israel. What late Comrade Lal Khan used to say, that the existence of Israel is similar to cancer on the map of Middle East. So basically, Israel is nothing but an outpost of US imperialism to impose its imperialist designs on the masses of Middle East, and to keep the region under check through a proxy state, which is called Israel. So I would also I would like to comment that there is no two-state solution of this conflict. As the history has shown, there can never be an independent, self-reliant Palestinian state in front of a huge imperialist state like Israel. So the Israeli plan of annexation of the West Bank is nothing but the perpetuation of Israeli aggression in the broad daylight. And it must be condemned and it must be resisted, not only in Palestine, not only in Middle East, but all over the world. And the revolutionaries, particularly the Marxists, have this duty to organize masses and clearly put forward a solution to this conflict, which is only possible through a socialist federation of the Middle East, in which the working class of Israel would have to play a decisive role. Because the history has proven time and again that liberation and independence of Palestinian masses is impossible until and unless the Israeli working class and youth enters into the arena of history against the Zionist Israeli state. And with the collective effort and the collective class struggle, capitalism is brought to an end in Palestine, in Israel, and in the whole Middle East, and a socialist federation of all nationalities based on volunteer membership is established.
Esta semana estuvimos intercambiando con ustedes sobre la compleja situación que vive Venezuela. ¿Quisieras decirnos un poco cuál es la opinión que tienen ustedes y de paso aportar a este debate tan importante entre los revolucionarios?
First of all, I would like to comment that the Bolivarian Revolution in Venezuela, which started in 1998, which brought forward Chavez as a mass leader, was a gust of fresh air in the post 1991 suffocating environment when the Soviet Union had collapsed and there was imperialist propaganda everywhere that socialism has failed. So it was a very important development in Venezuela, which proved that the class struggle had not ended, and there would be movements and there would be revolutions and there would be struggles in the coming years and decades. But the problem of the Venezuelan revolution is the absence of a revolutionary party, because of which the revolution is still unfinished in Venezuela. And Chavez was an honest person, and there are some similarities. In spite of many differences, there are some similarities in between what happened in Venezuela from 1998 to this day to what happened in Pakistan in 1968-69. So the absence of a revolutionary party basically gave rise to PSUV as a populist trend, as a populist tendency, which is a socialist party, which is a populist party, but not a Marxist party. And because of this absence of a subjective factor, the revolution in Venezuela has been a very slow motion, and it is still unfinished agenda, which have given rise to many other problems, such as the economic crisis in Venezuela, and which has given many chances to the imperialists to make their intervention in the country. What our position on Venezuela is basically that we should struggle to build a revolutionary party, Bolshevik party in Venezuela and in Latin America to bring an end to the capitalist system. But how to do it, it is another question. And we suggest that this should be done by intervening into the movement, into the PSUV, into the Socialist Party of Venezuela, instead of standing outside of the movement and outside of the party. We should go to the workers, we should go to the common supporters and voters of PSUV and explain to them that the only solution to the crisis through which Venezuela is passing is through completion of revolution and establishment of a socialist state and dismantling of the capitalist state and capitalist system as a whole. Then we should critically support the Bolivarian leadership, which is under Nicolas Maduro these days. Our criticism of PSUV leadership should be very different and in fact opposite to the right-wing criticism of the PSUV. And we should conditionally and critically support them. And if they take any anti-imperialist stance, if they take any, if they make any nationalization, or if they resort to any socialist measures against the imperialist intervention or the local bourgeoisie, we should support them. But at the same time, we should oppose any conciliatory policies by the PSUV leadership. And we should explain to the people that only through the complete overthrow of capitalism can their problems and their hardships be eliminated.
Por último, Imran, ¿quisieras agregar algo más?
What I would like to say is what Trotsky said in 1930s, about 100 years ago, that the crisis of our epoch has been shrinked to the crisis of leadership. So comrades, There have been movements, there are movements, there would be movements, there would be revolutions, there would be struggles, there would be resistances. But the only thing which is not present at the movement, the only thing lagging is a revolutionary party which could play a decisive role and provide leadership to these to these movements of working masses and the youth, and give them a direction towards the socialist revolution. So our task is to build that revolutionary party, not in our cities, not only in our cities, not only in our countries, not only in our continents, but world over. What I would like is like to say is that your struggle is our struggle, and our struggle is your struggle. So let's move forward and dismantle this system and overthrow this system through a socialist revolution.
Gracias, Imran.